such a bad song.
Fantastic. Okay, this has been Freaky for Boxing News TV in association with EsNews. I'm here with the one and only Barry Hearn. How are you doing today, Barry?
I'm always good, mate. Frightening, isn't it, really, at my age?
Yeah.
A bit better as I get older.
It's good, it's good. It's fantastic. How are you enjoying your stay in Saudi Arabia so far?
Yeah, I mean, I've been here a few times before, obviously, yeah. And I like the country, I like the people. The food's great. And, of course, the cream on the top of this cake is that we've got a Saturday night's action card I can't wait for. And that's the sort of thing that gets me out of bed. You know?
Yeah.
The worst thing is, if this didn't excite you, then you've already dead, aren't you?
Yeah,
you've got to appreciate what God gives you, and I'm just so happy to be here and to actually be part of the experience of what's going to be an unbelievable night.
Where does this rank among the events that Matchroom have put on over the years?
I think it's a question I've been asked a few times, and I've tried to evaluate it. The one I keep coming up with is this is probably as excited as I've been. I get excited a lot of times. There's a lot of fights out there. I've done
a few.
Over 1,000 cards, so it's 40-odd years. But I think probably Ben Eubank won in 1990 when we gambled literally everything we had because we weren't doing very well at the time. And we just thought that Eubank had the start to beat Ben, and thank God it worked out that way.
Yeah.
This is probably as excited as... I am excited now for this fight as I was for that.
Has Eddie sought any advice from you? I know he's his own man now, and he's...
We talk father to son, and we talk as director to chairman. You know, I mean, basically, there's 12 different sports at Matchroom. Each sport has different people in charge of it. They report to me, but not in a what-shall-I-do manner.
Yeah.
But basically, I run the financial side of the company, because that's what I'm good at. I'm good at numbers.
Yeah.
So... Whereas I always have an opinion, and I have to say my son ignores it all the time. And quite honestly, he's nearly always right.
That's good. But does he ever seek counsel for you when he's doing things like this that are big steps in the company?
Counsel's probably too strong a word. Sorry, schoolboy error.
But we were just talking about Eddie seeking counsel from you.
Yeah, I mean, like any son and father talk about things all the time. He has the final call on everything, but there are times when he'll say, especially with some of the older matters, you know, if there's a problem with a regulatory body or a commission that knows me for 30 years, he'll rope me in to be useful.
Leverage the relationship.
But on structural matters like making fights and contracts and all that, he doesn't need me. To be honest with you, he's a much better operator than I ever was anyway.
Do you think that's because he learned from you, though?
Well, I take that as a huge compliment, but he's learned and then he's taken it to another level.
Yeah.
And unfortunately for the rest of the boxing promoters in the world, he's operating at a level that if they went up that high, they'd run out of oxygen. Because I'm a fan. I mean, irrespective of him being my son, I'd like to think I could be complimentary if he wasn't my son.
Are you proud of what he's achieved?
I'm extremely proud of what he does because he's taken the sport to new levels, and that's something that you should be proud of.
Yeah,
you know, everyone's getting paid, everyone's making a living. This is a very dangerous sport. The fighters are getting respect. Eddie's making a profit. At the moment, life's a bowl of cherries, mate. Love it.
You're very well spoken, and so is Eddie. And Eddie's probably my favourite person to interview because I like to try and catch him out or see if I can beat him in an interview almost. It's like a game of chess with him. Does he get that from you, or has he learned it himself? Is it a skill he's always had?
Sometimes you're too close to someone to give an opinion, you know, because naturally the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, they say. The DNA is there.
Yeah.
But then the real art of being as good as you can be is what... that little something that you've got in you that you bring out to your advantage, which didn't exist before.
Yeah.
So, you know, certain basics, I think, I hope, honesty, integrity, emotion, passion, I hope he's got them from me.
Yeah.
And then he's added his own little mixture of his own personality to it.
Yeah.
And it's not, we're quite similar in lots of ways, but in terms of the way he operates, we're quite dissimilar because I was never as good as he was. And I think I'm still at the age where, from a business sense and from a sporting sense, I can acknowledge that exists. I'm not jealous of him. I'm not envious in any way of him. I'm appreciative of him. And I'm also realistic to say, I know how good he is. And it's scary how good he is because he lives it. He absolutely lives it. And that's that work ethic is something you can't invent. That may be the one thing he's got from me is I've always had a fantastic work ethic. I'm relentless. I'm absolutely relentless. I smile all the time, but I never give up. I keep going to, and he's got that. You know, if there's a fight he wants to make, eventually he'll get it. If there's a fight he wants, eventually he'll sign him.
Do you know that's funny? Because I always said to him, me and Eddie talk about Amir and Kell Brook a lot. I know Amir quite well. And I've asked him many times, do you chase this fight because you just can't not make it before they both retire? Do you think that's the case?
Yeah, definitely, because, and he's doing it for the right reasons, because they're only losers. The bigger picture, the real losers of that fight not taking place is Amir Khan and Kell Brook. And sometimes, for egos, or money, or splits, or weight, there'll be an excuse where that fight may not happen. And what they don't realise is that nothing in boxing lasts forever. Eventually, something happens, and we, this is where I'm being selfish, we, the fight fans, the British public, we don't get to see a fight that we really, really want to see. There's not that many of them out there. You know, Wilder Joshua would be another one. Joshua Fury would be another one. We feel cheated if we don't get the payback for being the passionate boxing fans that we are. But the real loser is the fighter themselves. And that's the sadness, because there have been lots of times where fights just didn't happen. In my own, in my case, I never get over the fact that I didn't do Ben Eubank 3.
Right, okay.
Because that was the fight I wanted to do. It was always the plan to finish.
I was only a youngster around those times, but did you try to do it?
Yeah. But then Ben signed with Don King, Eubank got beat by Steve Collins.
Right,
and
for
it, it didn't happen.
Different reasons it didn't happen,
But I felt we were robbed from the trilogy classic. And similar with Amir Khan and Kell Brook.
Various reasons we've been robbed of
them.
They both
basically need, I said to Eddie, they both basically need grabbing hold by the scruff of the neck and banging their heads on a wall and saying, just sign here, trust me, it'll be worth it. Because the value of that fight in commercial terms is dipping. And it will continue to accelerate that dipping as people say, nah, that was yesterday. Or as Eddie would say, on no context heard, I'll go on.
Do you think we'll ever, you mentioned sort of Wilder Joshua, Joshua Fury, do you think we'll ever see those fights?
I do. I think boxing works like that. I mean, you can never say for sure. You know, Joshua could get beat tomorrow, could retire. Or he could have a year off. Or Tyson Fury could decide he's going into, I don't know, I think he should go in the movies. He's a natural entertainer.
Yeah, he is.
You just don't know. We as boxing fans, we're the worst, aren't we? We always want what we want, irrespective of the fighter, really. We shouldn't be like that, but we are. So, naturally, we want it to happen. And people like Eddie, they sit in the middle of looking after the boxer's best interests, but also giving the fans what they want to see. And that's a difficult juggling act. To achieve. Sometimes you drop one of the balls, don't you? And you've got to get it and still keep the other balls in the air. It is a juggling act. But all we can do is give it our best shot. And
how do you think you would have coped if you were in the internet age, the social media age, dealing with... Eddie gets a lot of criticism online on social media. How do you think you would have coped with that?
Look, I get booed at the dance. I created dance. I get booed at the dance. It's just... It's banter. It's not real. It's just like, oh, is that... It's like when the wicked guy walks out on the pantomime. And the kids boo him.
They
don't know him. He's probably a nice guy, but they still boo him.
It's the nature of the beast.
Of the beast. Goes for the job. And promoters, proper promoters, and Eddie and I are proper promoters in our own work, in our own field. We develop a little bit of harsh skin.
Tough skin,
We have a crap at our skin. We have a great life. A few boos is not going to change our life.
Anything.
And actually, in a way, it almost becomes part of the show.
You enjoy it after a while.
Yeah, I enjoy it straight away, not after a while. At least the one thing, at least they recognise you. At least they give you some attention. Negative, it's okay. I was once talking to Don King about, why do you cope with everyone booing you, Don? Everywhere you go, people boo you. He said, I always carry a Stars and Stripes flag on a cocktail stick in my top pocket. And when they boo me, he said, I take it out and I wave it. They never boo the flag. And I thought that was pretty shrewd.
That's fantastic. That's playing the American people off against themselves. Yeah, fantastic. Moving on to the main event on Saturday. How are you feeling about the main event?
It's one of those great fights where I honestly couldn't tell you what's going to happen. You know, I can see three or four different scenarios playing out. In truth, I can bullshit you if you want. I had no idea. I had no idea. I got it totally wrong at Madison Square Gardens.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have done. I knew it was going to be a tougher fight than most people said, but I still didn't think Joshua could possibly lose, and he did. So the jury's out. We've got a 50-50 fight on our hands, and we should just bless the fact that we've got this type of fight. Because an age, for many years, there was a rhythm beyond most fights where everyone knew the result before the fight.
Yeah.
And the worst thing about any type of sport, whether it's soccer, cricket, boxing, if we know the result before it starts, any sport doesn't have the same appeal. There's got to be the doubt in your mind.
Yeah.
You've got to be able, obviously we sell a ticket to any show. Our job is to make sure you only need the edge of your seat.
Yeah.
And if we do that, whatever the result, we have to just take it, and we're professional about it. You know, if Ruiz beats Joshua, Eddie, I, whatever, we'll be the first people to congratulate Ruiz. If Joshua beats Ruiz, we'll be so proud because Joshua is our man, and we obviously want him to win. But we're honest. You know, we tell Ruiz. I told Ruiz's dad today, I want my man to win.
Yeah.
You want your boy to win. But the great thing about it, we can't influence the result. So
yeah.
We just sit there and we're the benefactor. We're the beneficiaries of what should be a wonderful evening of sport.
How do you think Joshua will approach the fight? Most people are expecting him to fight at range. Heard things that he's going to try and put a Larry Holmes type performance on.
I think the range is difficult, because if you're going to box on the back foot of range, it's much more difficult than boxing on the front foot of range. Ruiz's style doesn't really give you the opportunity to be on the front foot. Somehow he's got to hurt Ruiz a little bit to give him something to think about.
So you think he should revert to type? And
yeah, I think so, because I think Ruiz is, once he gets in his rhythm, he looks a complete fighter. He's got great feet, he's got great hand speed, he's got good head movement. He's not the prettiest fighter I've ever seen, but he is effective.
Yeah.
So I think for Joshua, he has a conundrum. Does he go in and hurt him early and try and get his Ruiz brain saying, let's be careful here, let's not go silly.
Yeah.
If he goes backwards and then gets lazy with his work, Ruiz is very good at cutting the ring off.
Yeah.
And if he gets up close, Ruiz is more dangerous than Joshua up close.
Do you think that'll give Joshua some demons, mental demons?
I think so much of sport is in the head anyway.
Yeah.
And I think this fight, more than any other, is in the mental side. On the one hand, does Joshua remember what happened at Madison Square Gardens? On the other hand, has Ruiz got softened by the fact that suddenly he doesn't have to struggle anymore? He's getting a massive payday. In his world, he's set for life. Does that take 5% off him?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this is it. There's two sides to the mental pressure on this.
Does Joshua's brain say, no matter what your mouth says, I don't fancy this?
Yeah.
Does that take 5% off him? This is why it's such a beautiful fight to speculate.
Yeah, yeah.
And we can't talk for hours about it because we're not going to get anywhere.
No.
Because I have no idea what's going to happen. And I love it. I love it for that.
On the undercard, we've got Dillian White.
Yeah.
It came out yesterday that he thought about quitting after what happened in light of the Rivas fight. Do you understand that, or what do you feel about it?
I would think it was a very short conversation.
Yeah.
You don't think about quitting. It goes through your head out of frustration.
A split second, yeah, yeah.
A split second, then you realise, you sit back and you go, hang on, let's not do, what else am I going to do?
Yeah, yeah.
What else am I going to do that pays this type of money and gives me this type of buzz and drives me to prove myself as a person, as an athlete?
What do you make of the whole Dillian situation? Obviously, we haven't heard from UCAD.
Listen, to my mind, the fact that UCAD haven't made, I think it is deplorable.
Yeah.
You can't hang someone out with unknown when we all know, everyone knows the situation.
Yeah.
His test is clear.
Yeah.
But
so what's taken them a year?
I don't know whether
it's... Oh, 6 months,
I think
sorry.
It's just bureaucracy.
Yeah.
I think it's a civil servant mentality of, you know, they're so paranoid about making a mistake, they'd rather say nothing.
Yeah.
And that's not fair on Dillian White.
Quite ironically, they put a tweet out today saying they want a communications manager.
They what?
They want a communications manager. They're looking to hire one.
Enough said. But we like Dillian. He's a great kid. He can fight. I think he's been messed around by them. I think he's been messed around by WBC with his mandatory. I think he's had a tough call. And he's a proper bloke.
Yeah, he is.
You know, he's a proper bloke and he's fighting. Yeah. And he wants to fight. And that's what put him in the position he's in. He's changed his life through boxing.
Do you think what's happened might affect his performance on Saturday?
No. I mean, he's a little bit bigger than I'd like to see him. I'd like to see him another stone lighter than that. The kid can fight. He's got a big heart. He's got big balls.
Yeah. Certainly has.
I wouldn't want to see him in the other corners of me, mate. I'd be jumping out of the ring.
Yeah, I would as well. I'd be running.
Yeah, no. I like him. And he's a quality fighter as well, and he's there on merit.
We've got three other fighters on the card who failed drug tests at some point in their career. How hard is it to build a card now or to look through some divisions and avoid these things?
The better the testing gets, it seems that more people fail.
Yeah.
The thing that people are missing is that this is the only issue. This is not people trying to cheat. These people need education as to what is right and what is wrong. And we can't, some of these guys that fight, they don't come from a background of being
sports
super
nutritious.
Smart education and let's go and read the little white book from the IOC. They trust people, they do things, maybe they don't think it through clear. I'm not making excuses for drug cheats, by the way, because some of them are dangerous when you take certain type of steroids and things like that. But at the same time, I think it's a period we're going through, which I don't see as a long-term period. I see it as an educational period where people think, I don't want to lose out, I don't want to have the stigma of being a drug cheat. And a drug cheat is just a word thrown around by newspapers and media people, because drug cheat can be 6 month ban for smoking marijuana.
Yeah. Could be taking an inhaler.
Could be eating bad venison.
Yeah.
It could be for taking the biggest steroid in the world that gives you a heart the size of a cow's heart. Yeah. So it varies, there's different levels, but we put them all in one bag. And probably that's wrong. But it is an educational thing, and I think there is work being done now because of past experience that a lot more fighters now are much more aware of the situation, are much more untrusting, are much more, they check their own because they realise it could affect their career. I think that's a good sign. So I'm hoping, and I think I'm right, that we're going through a period of clearing out any misunderstandings, also getting rid of the real cheats, of which there are some.
Yeah.
And I think the next generation that come through, I think are going to be much more educated and it's going to be a fairer world they live in.
If we had an incident where, and God forbid this ever happens, but someone got hurt in a fight and they'd lost to someone who had either previously failed, even if they'd served their ban, what would that do to the sport? What would it do to a promotional company or a organisation?
It's difficult to say because it's a hypothetical situation, but to take it to its wider ends, there's a possibility of a legal claim against someone if someone's hurt someone. That could be a criminal offence.
If someone had intentionally cheated in a fight, but even if they'd failed a test in the past previously.
To be honest with you, as I say, it's very difficult to give an opinion on hypothetical situations, but one thing's for sure, it wouldn't be good for the sport, would it?
No.
It'd be horrendous.
Yeah.
So we both know that, so we've got to do something about it.
Yeah.
And that's where VADA and these other drug people have all got to come in the UK. They've got to be as professional as we're trying to be professional.
Yeah.
And the easiest way to be professional is you deal with something, you take decisive action, and then you move on. You don't willy-welly around with hiding behind one-line press releases. If someone's guilty, throw the book at them.
Yeah.
Throw the book at them. And if they're not, come out and say, okay, we messed up, or there's no case to answer. But give some clarity, because in this business of boxing, you need to give other fighters the clarity of decisions so they understand. But it is a difficult business. In some ways, like with some of the athletics issues we saw, it became scientist versus scientist instead of athlete versus athlete.
Yeah.
It became country against country
for
honour and ego. So it's a lot more complicated than that. Boxing is much more primeval. It's me against you.
Yeah.
Do I take an unfair advantage to give me... Do I take something that gives me an unfair advantage against you? That's not allowed. So that has to be stopped. How do we stop it? And it comes under jurisdiction, it comes under follow-up, it comes up through action. And you mustn't be frightened to take positive action, one way or the other.
Fantastic. Final question, because I know you're eager to get your hair cut before tonight's event.
I think I've had the hair.
You're in the International Hall of Fame, if I remember correctly. Do you think we'll see Eddie in there soon?
Without a doubt. And I'm going to be very proud. I hope I live long enough, because I think we will be the first father and son inducted.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually.
That would be
an amazing thing.
Oh, mate, I'm welling up thinking about it. I'm so proud.
Fantastic. Well, it's been a pleasure speaking to you, Barry.
Pleasure, mate.
I hope to catch you again soon, my friend.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Barry. Sorry for keeping you so long.
No, I can't get in the air. I've got to get changed.